إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وأفضل الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة أيها المؤمنون عباد الله لقد بوب البخاري في صحيحه باب ما يتقى من محقرات الذنوب الإمام البخاري رحمة الله عليه He chaptered in his book Sahih al-Bukhari the chapter for that which is feared from the sins which are looked down upon. Then he mentioned with his chain of narration, قال حدثنا أبو الوليد قال حدثنا مهدي عن غيلان عن أنس رضي الله عنه أنه قال موجها الخطاب إلى التابعين رضي الله عنهم that Anas رضي الله عنه he turned to the تابعين from those who were there amongst them and he said to them إنكم لتعملون أعمالا هي أدق في أعينكم من الشعر كنا نعدها في زمن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من الموبقات You are doing deeds. These deeds in your sight, they are finer than the thread of hair. We used to consider these deeds during the time of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from the destructive sins. And Anas radiallahu anhu, as the people of knowledge have mentioned, كان من المعمرين الذين أطال الله أعمارهم. That Anas radiallahu anhu, he was from those that Allah Azza wa Jal gave them a long life. And he is directing this speech to the best of generations after the generation of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam and his companions who are the tabi'een. Giving them this reminder and telling them these deeds you are doing, you see them to be small in your sight. We used to see them and perceive them during the time of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasalam from the destructive sins. And this speech, Ikhwani Fillah, what should we perceive in this zaman that we are living in? بعد ألف وأربعمية وبدع وثلاثين سنة After 1430 something, some odd years. The sins that we may be doing today, which we are considered by many of us to be from the adat, from the customs and the norm, they could be from these destructive sins and even worse. فها نحن في زمن قد ظهرت أشراط الساعة The signs of the coming of the hour have become apparent. Many of them. As Anas radiallahu anhu also reports another hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari saying لأحدثكم بحديث لا يحدثكم به أحد غيري I will report to you a narration. No one besides me will tell you about it. And he said in this narration, من أشراط الساعة, from the signs that the hour is close, أنه يرفع العلم, the knowledge will be lifted. ويثبت الجهل, and ignorance will become widespread. ويكثر الزنا, and fornication and adultery will become widespread. ويشرب الخمر, and alcohol will be consumed. وتكثر النساء ويقل الرجال, that the women They will become many in numbers. And the men, they will become little. There will be from one man in equivalent in ratio, 50 from the women. And these signs are present If not all of them, then most of them. As the khamar, the alcohol is being consumed. And the zina is present amongst us. And the knowledge, much of it has been lifted. And the ignorance has become widespread. And this is within the ummah of our Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. Even amongst the Muslims. Even amongst the Muslims, more so in the likes of these countries. Ikhwani fillah, this is a sign of shar. This is a sign that evil has become widespread. And as Anas radiallahu anhu also reports another hadith, fi sahih al-Bukhari, when he said the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam told him, لا يأتي زمان إلا والذي بعده شر من حتى تلقوا ربكم سمعته من نبيكم. A time will not come except that the time which comes after it will be worse until you meet your Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are the steps that we are in. في زمن تباعد من زمن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. A time period which is very far from the time of our Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام. وقد اندرس كثير من آثار العلم. And the lampposts and signs and milestones of knowledge have become lifted amongst our ummah, many of them. And to Allah is our complaint. Ikhwani fillah, the ibadat that we are doing, these actions of worship which we have been commanded to do, they are asnaf, they are types, and they are of different levels with Allah Jalla wa Ala. And all of them are from the good deeds which we are in need of. لِتَثْقِيلْ مَوَازِينَ الْحَسَنَاتِ يَوْمَ الدِّينِ. To make heavy our scales of good deeds on the Day of Judgment in front of Allah, our Creator, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And from the signs and the traces of knowledge, and from the ibadat al-jaleela, and from the great actions of worship which have been lifted from this ummah in many a place and amongst many a people, is al-wara. This action of worship referred to as wara, which the noble scholar of Islam, Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullahi alayhi, defined as being tark ma yukhaf dararuhu fil akhirah, leaving off something that you fear its harm in the akhirah. This is what wara is. And this action of worship, due to the distance we are from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and due to, as our Messenger alayhi salatu wasallam has told us, a time period not coming except for the time period after it being worse, and us living in this state, this action of wara, many of us may not know. Many of us may not understand the action of wara. For this reason, we have chosen to remind ourselves of this great deed with Allah Jalla wa Ala. And this action, it is found in many ahadith, and it is reported from a great group of the companions by way of the actions that they used to do. Our Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he has told us in the hadith reported by Nu'man bin Bashir radiallahu anhuma, which is in al-Bukhari and Muslim, when he said alayhi salatu wasalam, inna al-halala bayin wa inna al-harama bayin wa baynahuma umuru mushtabihat. Indeed the halal is clear, and indeed the haram is clear, and between the halal and the haram there are matters which are mushtabihat, which are not totally clear. La ya'lamuhunna kathirun min an-nas. Many of the people, they do not know about these deeds. So the Messenger, he has clarified to us that the halal, it is clear, and the haram, it is clear, and between the two there are umur, there are matters which are mushtabihat, they are not totally clear to all of the people. Then he said alayhi salatu wasalam, فَمَنْ اتَّقَ الشُّبُهَاتِ فَقَدْ اسْتَبْرَأَ لِدِينِهِ وَعِرْضِهِ. The one who leaves off these matters of shubuhat which are doubtful, then he has put his religion as well as his honor into safety. وَمَنْ وَقْعَ فِي الشُّبُهَاتِ وَقْعَ فِي الْحَرَامِ. And the one who enters into these gray matters, he enters into that which is haram. Then he struck an example of this by saying alayhi salatu wasalam, كَالرَّاعِي يَرْعَى حَوْلِ الْحِمَى يُوشِكُ أَنْ يَقْعَ فِيهِ. The example of this is the example of a shepherd. He brings his flock to the boundary of another man. The sheep are grazing, and it is feared they may fall in and take graze from the property of another man. The Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam has struck this example, showing us the danger of these matters which are mushtabihat. They are not totally clear. And he has told us in this hadith, as a reminder for us, ayyuhal muslimuna ibadallah, that these matters which are doubtful and grey, if we fall into them, we may fall into the haram by way of them. And the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he has also told us in another hadith, the manner in dealing with these matters which are grey. We do not have a clear understanding, a transaction, a statement in speech, a marriage contract. Our whole lives are revolving around matters which may have in them certain things which are grey and we may not totally perceive and understand. How do we deal with them? What is the answer to these matters? Our Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he has told us how. In the hadith reported by Tirmidhi from Al-Hasan, who is the grandson of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he said in this hadith, radiallahu anhu, that he memorized from the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, that he said to him, دَعْ مَا يُرِيبُكْ إِلَى مَا لَا يُرِيبُكْ فَإِنَّ السِّدْقَ طَمَأْنِينَ وَالْكَذِبَ رِيبَةً. Leave that which causes you to doubt, and take that which does not cause you to doubt. For indeed truth, it is طَمَأْنِينَ, it will bring you tranquility. Truth will bring you tranquility. It will bring you peace of mind. It will bring you relaxation. It will bring you the ease that you're looking for in your life. And this truth is leaving off that thing which causes you to doubt. You are not totally clear about what is going on in this transaction or what is happening with these people from the deeds they are doing. And even from the actions of worship, there are many actions of worship which are innovations brought into the religion of Islam. So you having wara, asking yourself, did the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam do this deed? Is this from the way of the Salaf al-Salih, the pious predecessors who came before us, from the Sahaba and the Tabi'een and the Atba' al-Tabi'een? Is this their way? Did they do this deed that you are doing? If you have this in your life, you will have for yourself, my brother in Islam, the action which you are in need of to protect yourself from falling into the great matters. And he said at the end of this hadith, alayhi salatu wasalam, وَالْكَذِبَ رِيبَةً. And lying, it brings about doubt. Doubt in your religion, doubt in your life. And look at yourself and picture yourself in a scenario that may have passed. Something which brought about doubt to you, and you did it. Maybe you have remained days, months, years after that, remembering that deed that you did, asking yourself, wallahi, maybe that thing I did that time was wrong. You aren't aware and do not know how to correct it now as time has passed. Maybe you can't find that person. Maybe you can't find how to rectify it now and it has passed you. And the sabil to this is always the tawbah, returning back to Allah in sincerity, repenting to Him. As He has said, subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَتُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا أَيُّهَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. And repent to Allah, all of you as believers, so that you may be successful. Our Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he has told us in authentic hadith in Bukhari and Muslim reported by Abu Huraira, of this action of wara' and how it was found in some of the generations which came before us. He said in this hadith, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, أَنَّ رَجُلًا اشْتَرَى مِنْ رَجُلٍ عَقَارًا. A man, he purchased from another man a land, a property he purchased from him. He said, فَوَجَدَ فِيهَا جَرَّةً مِنْ ذَهَبٍ. He found in this land a clay vessel filled with gold. Look at this. This man, after purchasing the land, he finds in it a clay vessel filled with gold. What did he do? فَرَجَعَ إِلَى الرَّجُلَ الَّذِي بَاعَهُ الْأَرْضِ فَقَالَ خُذْ ذَهَبَكْ فَإِنَّمَا اشْتَرَيْتُ الْأَرْضِ. Ya subhanallah, he returned back to the man who had sold him this land. And he said to him, take your gold, for indeed I only purchased this land. فَقَابَلَهُ ذَلِكَ الرَّجُلُ بِوَرَعْ مِثْلِهِ. And that man who sold him the land, he met that man with wara and piety, the likes of that action. And he said to him, إِنَّمَا بِعْتُكَ الْأَرْضِ بِمَا فِيهَا. I have sold you the land and everything which is in it. Where are we from the likes of this wara? Some of us, if we were to find 20 pounds, 30, 10 even, maybe we would just take it without question, not wondering or asking ourselves, maybe someone who was in need lost this money. And this man, he finds a whole vessel of gold in his land which he has purchased, and he wants to return it back to the owner. This is from wara. And the owner says, that land and everything which is in it. Look at the wara of the people who came. Then when they had this differing amongst themselves, تحاكما إلى رجل, they went to another man to judge between them. And he said to them, ألي أحدكما غلام? Does one of you have a boy? And the other man said, and I have a daughter. And the man said, زوج الغلام بالجارية وأنفقوا عليهم من الذهب. Marry that boy or that man to the girl and give them from this ذهب. Look at this hukum. This man was a man of fiqh. He was a man of understanding. And he wished from this deed that Allah Azza wa Jal brings from the offspring of that pious man and his companion, children who are like their grandparents, fearful of Allah Azza wa Jal, have wara in their hearts, remembering Allah Azza wa Jal, and are not deceived by the mere gold and silver which is on the earth. And our Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he was the pinnacle. He was the best example of wara. He was the best example we could find for wara. Anas radiallahu anhu, he reports in Bukhari. And the Nabiya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kana yamurru bit tamar fi tariq yuridu an ya'kulaha fayada'aha khawfan an takun min as-sadaqa. The Messenger alayhi salatu wa sallam, he would and pass the pathways and he would find a tamar, one date on the road. He would wish to eat it. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would leave this tamar fearing that it was from sadaqah. As the sadaqah is haram upon the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam and Ahlul Bayt. And this one date, ask yourself, what could it benefit him from hunger? What could it bring about from alleviating the jew', the hunger which is causing the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam maybe to want to pick up a date from the ground and eat it? And yet he is fearing alayhi salatu wa salam that date, because it's from sadaqah, he may intake into his body that which is haram. Ya subhanallah, it is also found from the hadith of Abi Hurairah, a similar action which is in Bukhari and Muslim, that he would return back to his house alayhi salatu wasalam wa yaj'a tamra saqita 'ala as-sarir. He would find a date on his bed and he would take it and raise it to his mouth and then he would leave it, fearing that this was from the sadaqah. Our Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, who we have in him the best of examples, we have in him the way to follow if we're looking for happiness and success in our lives in the Jannah. Our Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, who has brought for us this religion of khair, the religion which will bring you into the pleasure of Allah Azza wa Jal. The more you hold onto his path, the more you hold onto his teachings, the more you are a pious Muslim, then you will be achieving the pleasure of Allah Azza wa Jal and something which will enter you bi-idhnihi jalla wa ala into paradise. Ikhwani fi Allah, the companions of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam were those who followed this guidance. They took from this wara' that the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam brought and they implemented it in their lives. And they were not deceived or fooled by the glitter and the amazing things which are found upon the earth. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, who we know his status in Islam, the first of the khulafa after the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam passed, the one who was the leader of the Muslims after the passing of our Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. Aisha radiallahu anha reports in Al-Bukhari an action that shows us the wara and piety that this companion had radiallahu anhu. She said, كان لأبي بكر غلام يخرج له الخراج. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he had a servant who used to bring to him the kharaj. Wal kharaj, this wording, as Al-Hafidh bin Hajar explains, it is that which the master, he puts upon his servant to bring him on a daily basis from wealth. So this servant would bring to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu from this kharaj. And one day he came to him and he brought him something to eat. فَأَكَلَ مِنْهَا أَبُو بَكَرَ رَضِيَ عَنْهُ. Abu Bakr, he ate from that which this servant of his had brought. Then the servant said, يَا أَبُو بَكَرَ تَدْرِي مَا أَكَلْتُ. Oh Abu Bakr, do you know what you have eaten today? And then he said, وَمَا ذَاكُ, what is it? And he went on to explain. The servant told him, إِنِّي فِي الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ قَدْ كُنْتُ تَكَهَنْتُ لِرَجُلٍ وَلَمْ أَكُنْ أُحْسِنَ الْكَهَانَةِ. In the time of Jahiliyyah before Islam, I practiced to do witchcraft and sorcery for a man. And I did not know what I was doing. إِنَّمَا خَدَعْتُهُ, I fooled that man. وَأَعْطَانِي بِذَٰلِكَ هَذَا. And he has given me today that which I has given, what I have given you. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he had eaten and ingested this food which this servant brought to him. There is no sin upon him. Yet what did Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu do? Was he satisfied with this entering his body? Was he pleased? ما كان منه إلا أن أدخل إصبعه في جوفه فقاء كل ما في كل ما في بطنه. أبو بكر رضي الله عنه he did not hesitate to put his finger into his throat and expel everything that was in his stomach. There's no sin upon him. There's no haram which he has done. Yet hating for something which is haram to be in his body is what caused him to do this. And this is from the wara' that you find in the companions radiallahu anhum. This great generation of people which we have in them guidance to follow. Maybe today in the society that we live in, more so than the Muslim lands, there are food which is entering upon us. Different ingredients in the food and the ice creams and the things we are eating. Yet we do not give time to even check the ingredients. Ikhwani fillah, this could be the reason why our dua is not being accepted. This could be the reason why we have been making dua all of these years for something and Allah Azza wa Jal, He has not accepted it. And the sin, it is upon us. We are the ones who are coming up short. We are the ones not caring what enters our bodies. And the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he struck an example of this in the hadith in Muslim from the hadith of Abi Huraira. When he struck an example of a man in a journey, أشعث أغبر يمد يديه إلى السماء. The man, he is in a journey. He is covered in dust and his hair is unkempt. He raises his hands to the heaven. Ya Rab, Ya Rab. He is invoking Allah Jalla fi Ula. He is in need of his creator. And the Messenger tells us, عليه الصلاة والسلام, ومطعمه حرام. The food that he eats is haram. ومشربه حرام. And the drink that he takes is haram. وملبسه حرام. And his clothing is from haram. وغذي بالحرام. And he has been nurtured upon haram. فأنا يستجاب له. How is this man to be answered? How is this man to be answered? The danger of ingesting and taking and not stopping to ask yourself, is this haram? Or maybe it hasn't haram. Likewise are the transactions in our businesses. Ask yourself, my brother in Islam, is what you're doing halal? Are you confident that if you were to meet Allah Azza wa Jal with the transactions and the business you are in and your occupation, that this would be something Allah is pleased with? Those who are successful in this dunya are those who ask. Those who constantly return back to their souls, looking at themselves and saying there may be a shortcoming. However, if we live a life where we feel comfortable going forward, continuing in our lives, and we are not stopping to look back at our deeds, this could be the reason why Allah Azza wa Jal, He punishes us on the Day of Judgment and we seek refuge in Allah Jalla wa Ala from this. الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه كما يحب ربنا ويرضى وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد إخواني في الله ما بدأت الإسلام we have heard in the first part of the khutbah the importance of this action of wara', this noble deed that we are in need of having, this great action of worship which will save us bi-ithnillahi azza wa jal from many sins. Asking yourself and inquiring, this is from the way to success. And moving forward without looking back, this is the path to destruction. And as we mentioned, that this was from the way of the pious slaves of Allah Azza wa Jal. Those who followed the guidance of our Messenger alayhi salatu wa salam. And Umar radiallahu anhu, he was from them. It is reported by Bukhari, rahmatullahi alayhi, from the hadith of Umar. أَنَّهُ فَرَضَ لِلْمُهَاجِرِينَ أَرْبَعَةَ آلَافِ That Umar radiallahu anhu, he made a portion of wealth which reached 4,000 coins to be given to those who came from Mecca to Medina from the Muhajireen. وَفَرَضَ لِإِبْنِهِ ثَلَاثَةَ آلَافٍ وَخَمْسَمِيَةٍ And he wrote a portion of 3,500 for his son, Ibn Umar. This was a just ruler, a pious man who feared Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He gave the rest of the Muhajirun 4,000. And he gave his own son 3,500. فلما سئل عن ذلك قال إنما هاجر أبواه. When he was asked about this, he said only his parents made hijrah. As Ibn Umar, Abdullah radiallahu anhu, at that time he was a child. So he was following his parents. So Umar radiallahu anhu, from his understanding and his fearing of Allah Azza wa Jal and having wara, he only wrote for his son 3,500. And this is from the piety we must have. Even with our own children, even with our wives, even with our closest companions. That the fear of Allah Jalla wa Ala makes us from those who unite upon piety, who are doing deeds for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And our Messenger alayhi salatu wa salam, he would teach even the young children. The young children, he would instill in them the likes of this wara. It is reported by Abu Huraira in Bukhari and Muslim. Anna al-Hasan radiallahu anhu akhadha tamratan faadkhalaha fi fi. That Hassan, who was the grandson of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as we mentioned, he took a date and he placed it in his mouth. فَأَدْخَلَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ إِسْبِعَهُ فِي فِيهِ وَهُوَ يَقُولُ قَخِينْ قَخْ أَمَا تَعْلَمْ أَنَّ الصَّدَقَ لَا تَحِلُّ لَنَا. The Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام took his finger and put it into the mouth of his grandson while he was saying قَخِينْ قَخْ, remove this, yuck, yuck, do you not know that the sadaqah is not halal for us? This is a young child that even if he was to eat from that which is haram, there is no sin written upon them. As the pens have been lifted, hatta yablo, until the young child reaches the age of puberty. And with this, our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he is giving him a teaching. He is instilling in him an etiquette and manner that will benefit him throughout his life. This is how we should be as Muslims with our children. They are watching things in the phones, in the televisions, on the laptops and the computers. We may not even know what is going on. The child, especially in this time that we live in, that the whole world has become one village. Something happens at the end of the world, and we find it today here. Something happens here, and it is found on the other side of the planet. We need to have this wara in our lives, so we may safeguard our children, so we may safeguard our wives, so we may safeguard our families and ourselves. Allah Azza wa Jal has put upon us an obligation to do so. وَأَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ وَالْحِجَارَةِ. Protect yourselves and your families from a fire whose fuel is men and stone. This is an obligation upon every single one of us, that we ourselves are upright, striving to uphold the religion of Allah. And this uprightness that we are doing, that it also enters our families, our wife, our children, our relatives. We are striving in doing this. And even the sahabiyat, the female companions of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, they were people of piety, people of wara. It is reported in Bukhari and Muslim, in the long hadith, that when the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, those from the munafiqoon, said about Aisha radiallahu anha, that which they said, and Allah Azza wa Jalla freed her from above the heavens, that she is bari'ah, she is free and pure and tahira from the lies that the munafiqoon made about her. The Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he came to Zainab bin Jahsh, who was from his wives. And he asked at that time, wanting to know about Aisha radiallahu anha. And Zainab radiallahu anha, being a woman of piety, one who fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, she said, أحمي سمعي وبصري لا أعلم إلا خيرا. I preserve my sight and my hearing, I do not know from Aisha except that which is good. And Aisha radiallahu anha, she says in the end of this narration, حَفِظَهَا الْوَرَعَ. She was protected and preserved by the wara', the piety that she had. Saying something that you have no knowledge of. And how much time do we find this upon our tongues? You may make a statement, not realizing the danger of it. As the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he told us, وَإِنَّ الْعَبْدَ لَيَتَكَلَّمُ بِكَلِمَةٍ لَا يَتَبَيَّنُ فِيهَا يُلْقَى فِي النَّارِ أَبْعَدْ مِمَّا بَيْنَ الْمَشْرِقِ وَالْمَغْرِبِ. The slave of Allah, he may say a statement, one statement. He is not realizing the danger of what he is saying. He will be cast in the hellfire, a distance further than the distance between the East and the West. One statement that we might have made, we ask Allah to forgive us, subhanahu wa ta'ala. One statement, and it is a reason we are cast in the hellfire, a distance further than that which is between the East and the West. This is the piety, this is what is needed in order for us to be saved, this wara. If we have it in our lives, our tongues will be held. Our tongues will be safeguarded from falling into the likes of these dangerous sins. Ikhwani fillah, we have taken in this a reminder as to the importance of wara. And this will be the thing that will save us bi-idhnillahi azza wa jal. And this sifa of wara was found in those who came before us from the tabi'een, the sahaba, and all of those generations of khair, the salaf al-salih. And in them we have every goodness. So let us strive in ourselves and be from those who hear the good and make effort in implementing it. These khutab, these Friday sermons, they have not been legislated except for this purpose. That you hear khair today, that tomorrow may help you in your life. And it should not be that we hear the khair and continue, and it goes in one ear and out the other, a'adhan billah, and has no effect upon us. نسأل الله عز وجل بمنه وكرمه وتفضيله أن يوفقنا إلى خير ما سمعنا والحمد لله رب العالمين.